So he knows everything, he's seen everything, and we just want to scrap on him every time we have an opportunity. Thanks for creating this, Dr. Deepak. And I mean,
you are very kind, Girish. Don't little.
Thank you, sir. I think guide wire is a little boring subject because it is less of animations and more of theory. But today, as Samuel sir was saying, people, without understanding the construction of each of the hardware, most cardiologists perform many interventions with very little knowledge about what is the basic structure, construction, and utility of each of the hardware that are available in the armamentarium of interventional cardiology. And I've been asked to speak about the angioplasty guide wires. I think if you have selected your guide catheter correctly, the most second important thing is to choose the guide wire. These two together, if you have chosen the right guiding catheter for a support and adequate visualization, engagement, and coaxiality, second most important thing is the guide wire. So what are the functions of the guide wire? You need to track through the vessel depending on its anatomy. You need to access the lesion, whether it's in the proximal, mid, or distal, at a bifurcation, whether it is tortuous, calcified, fibrotic. So depending on that, you need to choose the wire. So it's important to access the lesion. And then after entering the lesion, you need to exit atraumatically without causing dissections or perforations. And finally, the guide wire needs to give you support to take your subsequent devices like balloons and stents. So this is the basic function of a guide wire, the purpose. Now, for this, we need to understand certain fundamental things. What are the characteristics of the guide wires that you would like to have? One wire would not have all these characteristics. That's why, depending on your vessel anatomy and the lesion characteristics, we need to choose. So what are the characteristics? One is the torque control. What is the torque control? It is the amount of rotation that you give at the proximal end and how much rotation happens at the distal end of the guide wire. That's called torque control. That's force transmission from proximal to distal end. Next one is called trackability. It's the ability of the wire to follow the wire tip around the curves and bends without bucking or kinking. Trackability means it needs to take the shape of the vessel without kinking or buckling. Next is steerability. It's the ability of the guide wire tip to be delivered to the desired portion of the vessel. Means in spite of the tortuosity, in spite of the calcified lesions or acute bends, I need to finally take the wire to the distal part. That is the steerability. Next comes the flexibility of the wire. It's the ability to bend with direct pressure. So when you apply a pressure, it needs to bend and take that shape and go. And then comes prolapse tendency. The wire has a tendency to prolapse. What do you mean by prolapse? I'll show you some images. It's the tendency of the body of the wire, not the tip. Body of the wire not to follow the tip around the bends. You know, the tip has about distal 30 millimeters and then there is a body. So this body, does it go along with the tip? It's like a tractor, the engine of the tractor and the trailer of the tractor. Do they both go together? If don't, then it's called prolapse. Then is the radio opacity and visibility. These are very important when you're doing very complex lesions or chronic total occlusions. You need to see what is happening to the tip of the guide wire. Is it in the lumen where you want? Has it migrated outside or has it got deformed? You need a good radio opacity for the visualization. And next most important thing is the tactile feedback. When I pass the wire from the proximal end, I need to feel what is happening to the tip of the wire where it is in contact with the vessel wall. I need that feeling. That's called tactile feedback. The better feedback, then less chance of perforation or dissections. And then there is something called crossing. Crossing of the wire means is the ability of the guide wire to cross the lesion with little or no resistance. So it should just slip through it without touching or penetrating any of the intima. And then lastly comes the most important when you're doing little tough lesions is the support. It is the ability of the guide wire to support passage of another device or a system, means to taking a stent or a rotablator or a microcatheter or a stent, a balloon. That is called the support. It is not anything to do with the wire, but what can be carried on the wire, that is this support capability of the wire. So the characteristics of the wire have multiple, about 9 of them. Torque control, trackability, steerability, flexibility, prolapse tendency, radio opacity, tactile feedback, crossing and support. Please spend a little while to understand, and each of the wires that you already have on your shelf, where do they fall in terms of their steerability, torque control, prolapse tendency, so that you can choose correctly. So now, when we look at the guide wire building, it has 6 components. 3 are with the core components and 3 are on the external components. Core means the inner part of the guide wire. The core material is important. It is either stainless steel or high tensile steel or nitinol. These are the common materials used. Then there is something called core diameter. The larger the diameter, there is more weight at the tip of the wire and less prolapsing of the wire. That is the core diameter. And third one is the core tapering. The core inside, does it carry the same thickness till the tip? If it does, then it has a lot of penetrability, but less of steerability or less of slipping through a lesion. But when the core tapers, it can track the micro channels and it can exit. So core has 3 things. What material it is made of. Next, what is the diameter of the core? The thicker the core, it can go through most of the lesions. Third, as it tapers, it allows you to track tortuous lesions, or the tortuous lesion, not the vessel, tortuous lesion, or where there are micro channels. Now, coming onto the surface, external components. Apart from this core, which is their steel wire or a nitinol wire, you have coatings on top of them, that blue color thing that you see. They could be hydrophilic or hydrophobic coatings. And then there are coils and covers that they cover the distal part of the core. These are not coatings. Coatings is only on this part, that is the more proximal. The distal parts are either distal part of the core is covered with coils or with the covers, which are PTFE and things like that. And then you look at the tip of the design. How is it made? I'll go into the details of them. Okay. For example, if I have to show you on regular BMW that we use, the core is stainless steel, the proximal segment, and the middle portion is nitinol, which tends to retain its shape and memory shape is good. And then as it goes distal, there is a tapering. There is a 3-stage tapering of this central core, one stainless steel and then nitinol. And as it approaches the last, not at the tip, but the majority of the distal part, it tapers further. That leads to a hydrophilic. On top of that, you have coating. That's the hydrophilic coating, which allows it to slip through. And this is hydrophilic, means when it comes in contact with water, it becomes like wax. But the final about 5 to 6 millimeter is hydrophobic. And this means this remains slippery, but it will not penetrate through the distal vessel and perforation chances are less. If it's hydrophilic, the chance of perforations are more. So this is how buildup of the wire happens. So now coming to the core materials, what are the 3 types? There is stainless steel, then there is a durasteel, and then nitinol. Each one has their own advantage. If you use a stainless steel that goes from the proximal to the distal end, this has great support. You can take even rotablator on a stainless steel wire. That is the support it gives. It gives good pushable force and also good torque. You can rotate it because there's a single shaft from top to bottom, which is stainless steel. When you use durasteel, it is a high tensile strength. It has 28% higher strength. So it is more durable and better torque. It can turn as you turn proximally, the distal turns very effectively. And you also can see that the central core is not thin. It is much larger. So it gives you much more durability at the tip retention shape. When you come to the moving arm, unlike stainless steel, it is more durable and it can be used for multi-vessel or multiple times in India, you know that. And it has excellent flexibility and steering. Because it's nitinol, it can go through bends and the tough lesions. And the durable tip shape retention means once you shape the tip, it is retained probably for next 30-40 minutes while you're taking out, repositioning or going to multiple branches. It still retains. That is the beauty of nitinol. It has a memory. Looking at the core diameters, when the core diameters is thin, there is a better distal access. It can go to the most distal vessels. And it, the contrary, because you access that, you lose support. Since the thickness becomes less, the support means taking a bulky device on the wire becomes less possible. When you take a larger diameter, that means more support and more torque. It turns very well and it holds on to that. So if you're treating very proximal disease, you should use larger diameter, more support and torque wires. When you're treating more distal lesions, you should take something which is more flexible. So what I mean by that, this is what it means. When you look at the core is uniform and large and tapers a very short distance. The body tends to follow the tip, right? It does not collapse too much. But if you have conventional tapered core, means at multiple areas it is tapering and there is a big joint where there is a thick portion of the core and then the thinner portion, every time you push the wire, the tip enters the lesion. So in these situations, you must not use regular junction wires where there is thick and thin core are attached because body is not going to follow the tip. Choose a guide wire which is tapered uniformly without sudden transition in the diameter. Then the body follows the tip like in the proximal like plate. And also, when you look at the core, this I was talking about transition, the thickness, diameter of the core. Now I'm going to the core tapering. You can see here, the longer taper, the tip gradually tapers and it's narrow over a period of long distance. Here, the wire, the body tends to follow the tip much more easily compared to there's a shorter transition between broad segment of the core to a narrow segment of the core. So always choose when you have acute angulation, like you have a left main to circumflex lesion where circumflex originates more than 100 degree and there is an ostial circumflex lesion, exactly the way it is shown here. Regular wire is not going to follow. You need to find a tapering core and also probably a much broader core. You need to choose a wire which has this. I will show you. This is just for elucidating it. Now, coming to the coatings of the wire. Coating means lubrication, lubricity, and tracking. So when the tip is coated and lubricated, it tracks a little more challenging acute bends or lesions which are a little tougher much easily. So you have two kinds of coating. One is hydrophobic coating. The other one is hydrophilic coating. Hydrophobic means it repels water to create a smooth, slippery, wax-like surface. It repels it. So no actuation with the water required. And it reduces the friction and provides device trackability. See, when you go back to the hydrophilic, it attracts water to create a gel-like. Here it appears like wax, means when you throw water on the wax, you know, small water droplets form and they help you to keep lubrication. But when it is hydrophilic, it absorbs water and becomes like a gel. Everything goes through it. Minimizes the friction and better trackability. Then what does it differ? Then what is the difference between hydrophobic and hydrophilic? What is the difference is both of them reduce the friction and both of them increase the trackability, but one becomes gel-like, the other one becomes wax-like. The difference is the hydrophilic ones, since they become gel-like, they can perforate the distal vessels. So when you are into diffuse disease vessels, distal branches are small, avoid hydrophilic wires because they pretend like they're finely coated with a gel and they can pass through the distal vessels and cause perforations. So when you handle hydrophilic wire, be cautious about distal where the distal wire is. Now, the lubricity and tactile feedback. This is another thing. When there is a gel-like thing, you don't feel the feedback all that well, but when it is wax-like, you feel a better feedback. So when you try to increase the lubrication, there is a polymer cover with hydrophilic coating. It slips through any of most of the lesions. And hydrophilic coating alone, without polymer cover, causes a little less lubrication, but it gives you slightly more tactile feedback. And when it is hydrophobic coating, like in a BMW or something, it is less lubricated, but you get better feedback from the tip. And then there are total non-coated wires, like, you know, rotor wires, where there is absolutely no lubrication, so it does not go through the lesions easily or tortuous lesions easily, but it gives you a fantastic feedback from the tip. Both of them have a role. Lubrication has a role. Tactile feedback has a role. When you're trying to cross tougher lesions, you want good tactile feedback. If you don't have a feedback from the tip, you may perforate or you may dissect inside without even knowing, because the polymer coated, hydrophilic coated, polymer covered and hydrophilic coated wires can easily go into the subintima and make you feel that there is no resistance as though you're in true lumen. But when you take a hydrophobic coating, it does not slip through a tough lesion, but it gives you a good feedback. So find something which always gives you little feedback. That's why hydrophilic coating without a polymer is good. But when you have very tough lesions proximally, especially CTOs, polymer covered hydrophilic coated ones are good. If you cannot penetrate the proximal cap, at least you can go proximal subintimal and then enter back into the true lumen with exchange of hydrophobic coated wires. Hydrophilic wires will not help you to re-enter the vessel once you have exited. They're good to access subintima, but not good to come back into the intimal layer. Now, coming to the polymer covers, you can see here, the full polymer cover means very slippery. We are like a Pilot 200 or Pilot 100 wires. And then you have partly intermediate polymer cover, means half of it is covered with polymer and the rest half is not covered and they are exposed. They are called hybrid wires, like Xian Blue, which gives you a great trackability. At the same time, the tip does not cause so much danger and also gives you a certain amount of feedback because this is not covered with polymer. And there are other ones called bare coils. There is no polymer on the tip at all. So these are the ones which gives you a fantastic feedback, especially use them for these Gaia series and other CTO wires, which do not have so much cover. So the guide wire covers, and do not confuse them with coating. Coating is more proximal. The covers are at the tip mostly. They provide smoother surface for hydrophilic coating, smooth tracking through a tortuous vessel, and not to be confused with hydrophilic coating, which is more proximal. So look at the tip. Polymer tips help you to slip through a tougher lesions. Now, let's come to the, why do we have coils at the end of the guide wire? On the stainless steel body, you have these coils, which helps you to maintain the constant overall guide wire diameter. If the tip becomes very thin, the core, you know, the wire cannot become so sharp. It can perforate and go out or enter into the subintima. That's why you need these fine wires, which maintain the constant diameter of the tip of the wire. Next, this allows for tip shape retention. When you have a coils, compared to core bending, wire bending, these coil bending helps you to retain the shape better. And also, because they are coils, they gives you a better feedback. Otherwise, the sharp object would have, you know, penetrated and not given you a good feedback. And also, because there is such dense coils, they give you good visibility to know where the distal wire is. Now, coming to the tip styles, there are, you need either for steering or tip stiffness. Either you need to rotate through a, you know, complex anatomy, or you need to penetrate through a cap. So core to tip, if you see, the precise tip control is important. When you have a precise tip like this long core going till the tip, you have better steering. You turn, the proximal distal will turn, and also it gives you a good tip load, means it gives you enough strength to push against a hard substance distally and penetrate through it. So if you have the core which extends from the proximal part which is in your hand to the most distal part, that's called core to tip, is the core composition, then it gives you better steerability and it gives you better penetrating or tip load. When the shaping of the ribbon, the core ends much before the tip, then the shapeability becomes better and the tip becomes atraumatic, because the pushability does not reach the tip, and this wire can be used for prolapsing. At those junction, when you want to do a knuckle technique or something, you can use for prolapsing the wire. So this is what, you know, talking about all this construction helps you to understand torque control, trackability, steerability, flexibility, prolapse tendency, tactile feedback, crossing and support. Now, what are the other terminologies? Working length. Usually the wire, you can see at the bottom of the picture, the last 3 centimeters to 30 centimeter is the workable. The 3 centimeter helps you to cross the lesions, and the remaining 27 centimeters helps you to take the balloon and the guide. Both segments are important. Tip flexibility, that means amount of flexibility at the distal 3 centimeter. This is very, very crucial. The distal 3 centimeters will give you a what you call flexibility, whether it will bend, non-bend and all that. Then the tip load, this is the amount of force in grams it takes to buckle the most distal 1 centimeter. The last 10 millimeter of wire tip to bend, how much force you need to put, that in terms of grams is called the tip load. You want the less load in a type A or type B lesions, but once you're into type C lesions or you want to do a CTO, you want more tip load to cross them. Then there is something.
Girish, how much time you'll need take, Girish?
Maybe then I'll conclude by showing on 5 cases, sir. 3 minutes?
Yeah, give them a practical tip towards which wires would be your first choice and why, and what are to be avoided, what are the issues related to that. Can you do that?
I'll do that, sir. I think I came to that. The guide wire selection may be influenced by the vessel takeoff, that is acute or obtuse, vessel anatomy, whether tortuous, or lesion location, whether osteal, proximal, or distal, or lesion morphology, means just plaque rich in cholesterol or calcified or fibrotic, and then the device strategy. You want to do microcatheter, or you want to take a rotablation and other things. For a left main angioplasty or a very osteoproximal LAD, if it's a type A or B lesion, any wire can be used. Preferable to use common wires which have least traumatic tips and have got at least medium support to take your the devices like stents and balloon. But if you're doing osteal left main or osteal RCA, better to use an extra support, because the whiplashing would be much lesser. In the bifurcation, for the primary lesions, you can choose what you want, but the side branch, there's always a possibility of jailing. You can use both hydrophilic coated or non-hydrophilic, but avoid polymer coated the wires, which may get entrapped on or get stuck. The risk of wire rupture during pullback is slightly more when you use polymer jacket. In a case like acute ST elevation MI, when you see there is soft plaque and atraumatic wire is your preferred choice, less tendency to stay subintimate, and support usually less crucial, but thrombectomy device can be bulky. In this case, you can see here, there's a proximal subtotal occlusion, maybe, and when it is subtotal or a total, it is better to have a wire whisper, which is configured like this. I will just show you an image of the wire. This wire is like this, just for your understanding. It's a polymer cover, goes up till the tip, and the core to tip is the metal, and it is a parabolic grind which gradually tapers down. Next, it's the same. If you have something like that acute MI, you can use, in such situations, you can even use a regular wire like BMW, but always better to use a whisper so that you sleep in much easily. But keep a watch on the distal tip. So this is how you can access without much effort, and you can do thrombectomy and then stent or whatever is to be done. Now, when you have a distal tortuosity, here this is a post-bypass patient, the Lima had failed, and she came for unstable angina, and there's a very tight proximal and distal lesions. So we are worried about how to cross the proximal lesions, but we're also looking at how to cross this. If you pay attention to the mid to distal portion, there's almost 360 degree curve, and then the wire goes down. We took BMW wire initially, not focusing too much on the distal segment, and then tried a whisper, tried, another hydrophilic wire like, Pilot 500, it did not cross. Then finally, we had to go to a Sion blue wire. So you can see that knot-like thing in the LED could be crossed with the help of this wire purely because the way it is constructed. Simply because the way it is constructed. How is it constructed? There is a 50% which is coated with nitinol, 50% is bare, and it is very flexible and at the same time atraumatic. So it can take a 360 degree turn and go through that. You can see this. It's taking that 360 degree turn and straightening that segment and go. So when you have something like this, you need to select depending on the way the wire is constructed. That's why it's important to understand how these things are made and how to select your wires. Now you have here another case of acute unstable angina post-bypass where a graft failed to a PDA and came with acute inferior wall MI. This is how the lesion looks. Quite along the distal part of the circumflex is occluded. So initially we tried with a whisper wire, it did not go. We thought we should either take a Fielder XT or we should take a Pilot 100 or 200. But then eventually we decided upon Fielder XT. Why? It's again the stainless steel core which goes till the tip that gives you a beautiful transitionless without any transition. So torqueability is excellent. And the distal one is hydrophilic coated, so it will slip through subtotal occluded because post-CABG means very chronically occluded disease. This is not something thrombotic. So you need to track through a channel like you can see below. And it is again, there is a polymer on top of it. And inside, again, you have what we call the, the wires, coils. So it helps you to maintain the tip shape, because you make a very small, at the end of about 3 or 4 millimeter, you make a 30 degree bend, you can access any of it with this help of this wire. And this is how we got into that place. After failing with two wires, we could cross with this. Why? Because it does not prolapse. The tip does not prolapse as much as other wires. And it gives you a very good support over a period of you know, the distance, and it easily tracked until the distal. And it's important to take help of microcatheter if you're in a challenging situation. Now, if you're into certain calcified lesions, you know, this man presented an acute enteral wall MI. It is not a CTO lesion. It's an acute enteral wall MI, and this is how the lesion is. Probably he had a very dense, severe coronary artery disease, calcified lesion, and a small thrombus occluded the remaining channel. So we tried initially with, you know, many wires, including Whisper and hydrophilic coated, even Pilot, did not cross. Then we had to take non-hydrophilic, tough wire, you know, the ones with a higher tip load like Gaia 2. And you can see here, we had to take a microcatheter. My request to all young doctors, in whichever lab you're operating, please keep some, you know, hardwares like a microcatheter, like a GuideZilla, like a thrombus aspiration, wherever you work, keep a couple of them. And also on the shelf, keep a couple of, you know, complex wires like Gaia 3 or, you know, Pilot 200. If you're caught up in a situation where you cannot cross, you can try these. And then exchange these wires. Remember to exchange these wires. Never do angioplasty on these wires. Exchange them to a regular workhorse BMW or a extra support before you take other device like balloon and stent. And if you have a very tortuous vessel, again, this I just did yesterday. I had nightmare. Look, I have addressed the left, both the vessels easily. Looking at this, it looks very innocuous, large lumen. But whatever I may try, you know, the wires would not cross the mid segment. And it was so tortuous in Arevo, and no wire. We tried Whisper, Sianbu, Pilot. Even I tried, you know, the Fielder XT without a help of a microcatheter, hoping that, you know, it's such a big one. Nothing would cross. I took 30 minutes to just cross such an open vessel. Then we realized later that there was a chunk of the calcium which was blocking that. So when I took the help of the microcatheter and then passed, it really took. So when you have a tortuosity, it's important to have thin tapered wires which are hydrophilic, which you take you through the lesions, and then you exchange them. Never leave them. Don't operate on them. Exchange them with a workhorse wire before you come back to your intervention. Here again, you have a subtotal occlusion enteral wall MI, but pretty tortuous. You can see right from the ostium, the lesion seems to be tortuous, or the you know, calcium has pushed it to one corner. So again, we tried with regular Whisper wire, Sion Blue, Fielder XT, we could not cross. In a myocardial infarction situation, again, we had to resort to Gaia 2 to access. So do not hesitate if you know how the wire is constructed and what to watch for. When it helps you, it also can harm you. So for the last touch on the CTO wires, you need a penetration force, you need a pushability of the wire, you need steerability, means you need to direct it to the area that you want. You don't want to go to the intimal side, away from the intima, and you want the tip to retain its memory till you penetrate it through the plaque. So you need a penetration force, pushability, steerability, and shaping memory. So when you look at the wires, either you have non-tapered or tapered, when you either have a hydrophilic or non-hydrophilic. Hydrophilic are good to access the proximal part of the cap, but not good to exit the lesion. Non-coated, non-hydrophilic, hydrophobic ones are very good to enter into from the subintima, enter into the lesion or true lumen and stay within the lumen. And this is how to summarize. If you have a regular straightforward controlling, you need to enter through a hydrophilic wire, then try and exit through a non-hydrophilic wire. In the third lesion, you can see there's a small tracking microchannel. You can use a sliding technique that either Fielder XT or FC can be of use. And sometimes there can be a concertina effect because of a hard shaft or what you call stiffer shaft. Once you change over to a softer vessel, you can see the graft so beautifully it opens up. In summary, your success depends on choice of your wire. So for that, you must understand, spend a while to read about the construction and each part of the wire and look at each strength and the risks that they bring upon when you once you take onto your hands. So for a straightforward anatomy, use a trustworthy workhorse like a BMW or a Whisper. But once you need more support, use an extra support wire alone or a buddy wire when stent or balloon don't track. And for more tortuous or calcified lesions, use hydrophilic polymer-coated wires like Whisper or what do you have, Pilot 200 to cross the lesions with the least risk of resistance, but it also can cause you a perforation. Remember that. Thank you, sir. And for subtotal occlusion and CTO, it's always better to use a wire like Fielder XT to begin with, and with the help of a microcatheter, and upgrade it to stiffer tipped wires later. And when you're not sure where you're going and what is happening, it's always better to use a microcatheter inside which you can constantly keep changing your wires depending on how much trackability, force, or penetration power you need. Thank you.
Thank you, Girish. I think he gave us all the description of the various types of wires, and first time we are unable to spend much time with him. But I just want to sum up his presentation. Which is the wire you would use as your workhorse wire, Deepak, Girish?
I think at this point, BMW is the wire is the workhorse for me, sir.
Okay. My personal advice to all of you, today there are at least 20, 30 different types of wires are available. You must learn for the youngsters who are coming up or just starting or 100 cases or less, you should start with one wire which you are familiar, continue to use that, and then keep on graduating from that. Because somebody said in a meeting, you can use this wire, that wire, you can use, now Girish said, we can use a Gaia for difficult lesions, doesn't mean that you must go ahead and start using Gaia for all difficult lesions. So you will land up in trouble. You upgrade yourself slowly. Don't be in a hurry to keep on upgrading, and try to understand and then go forward. Now we'll have to go back to Shiva, are you?
I'm here, sir. Yes, sir, I'm here. I have shared my slides through mail, and hopefully, if they can share me back. Am I audible, Deepak?
Yeah,
Sir. Yeah, Lijo, I requested Lijo to do share my screen.
Yeah, Lijo, we can do that.
Or Deepak, you can.
Yeah. Shiva, we are running short of time. We are already half
day late. Sir, by the time Shiva is sharing his screen, sir, what is your workhorse at this point of time? We know that you are a great fan of BMW wires. Now with the newer wires, the VersaTurn and all, have you slowly switched over to something new? Or what is your workhorse at this point of time?
BMW Universal is my workhorse wire.
Yes, sir. Happy to hear
each other wire. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just...
Before